Hello and welcome to the course of UPSC 2019 GS Paper 1 Analysis. It is presented to you by Plus Pramesh e-Library, and here is your mentor for the course. This is me, Supriya Singhal. Here you can read about me, some more details, and you can also follow me on Instagram, which is basically by the name of Crispy Stories. Here you can personally directly message me and I will reply to you. Okay. So now what we'll do is, just like we had taken 4 questions in the previous class, we'll also take 4 questions around in this class also. Okay, and we'll do both Indian society as well as some questions of history and geography. So whichever will come first. Okay, now the first question that we'll discuss in the class today is basically question number 9 of the GS paper 1. Okay, and the question is, empowering women is the key of controlling population growth. Discuss. So now, as I told you, that these key elements like critically analyze, critically, then it will be discuss, then it will be elaborate, then be illustrate. Okay, so these plus there will be many few more. Okay, wherein you will find that UPSC is using these keywords either in the starting or in the end. Okay, of the question, and you need to actually follow that approach. Okay, so when See, whenever there is a discussion, that means what? You are giving them some idea. So discussion is always followed by a conclusion, because discussion cannot be left without the conclusion. So what you will do is, you will write whatever you want, but in these type of questions, conclusion is a must. Okay, so now we will look at the question. So the question tells you, the question is asking you that empowering women is the key of controlling population growth. So just like every question, we will have an intro, we will have a body, and we will have a conclusion. Now, what do you write in intro, body, and conclusion? So see, here the main theme is what? I told you main theme always comes in body. But whatever is the fringe element will come in introduction, and conclusion is just like one line or two lines. Okay. So now, it is asking you about empowering women, wherein you have to write about that, and how empowering women can lead to population control of population growth. So that is what will come in the main body. Okay, that how if you empower women, it will lead to population growth control. Okay, then what will come in introduction? You will write about the need of empowerment of women to control population. Why? Because of population expansion. Okay, so in this way, what you do is, you give the examiner what the question was asking. Okay, so now in the introduction, what you can write? See, I'm writing here introduction. So what you can write in introduction is saying that India is soon to become world's most populous country. Okay, leaving behind China. Okay, currently the population is around 1.3 billion. Okay, and will soon touch 1.7 billion. Now what you have done is, you've given examiner an idea that you know what is going on. And then if you want to connect the introduction and body, you will write, and thus rises the need of population control, population growth control, and empowering women. Okay, and now, so okay, so either you can stop at this population growth, or you can extend it further by writing that empowering women is also is as a tool to control population. I would not say that write this empowering women, because then in body again you'll have to repeat it. So what you do is, you write an introduction of what? You write an introduction how India is the most populous country. Okay, what is the current population and where it is achieving. Okay, and then you will write that there rises the need of population growth control. Now what you'll do is, you'll come to body, and in body what you will do is, in body you will, the first line that you will write is that empowering women leads to population growth control. Okay, and how will it lead to population growth control? So what you do is, see, either there are two ways to solve this problem. Either you take each element. Okay, how empowering women can lead to population growth control. For example, if women is educated, she will not get married early. She will not get married early. She will not get not have early. She will not have kids too early. Okay, and thus your population growth happens. So now you can write it in words, or you can write in flowcharts. I prefer flowcharts because there are very few questions anyways in UPSC that give you this opportunity where flowcharts seem to be a very nice answer. Okay, so what I'll do is I'll start making flowcharts here because words even you can write, but flowchart is something that I need to teach to you. Okay, so what we'll take is first is how empowering women leads to population growth control. So write here that empowering women includes, okay, political, social and economic empowerment. ठीक है, political, social, economic, educational empowerment of women. And then what we'll do is we'll show how each of these empowerments will lead to population growth control. Okay, so now what we'll do is first you will write educational empowerment, okay, of women. So now here what you do is you put basically a bracket, you put a flowchart, you put a square box like this and you write women, education of women. Okay, now education of women, that means what? She is in school या college, okay, till the marriageable age. Okay, यहाँ से क्या हो जाएगा, the problem of child marriage, okay, also solved. फिर इससे क्या होगा, the problem of too early, too many, also solved. Now what is this too early too many? So too early too many is generally a line which is used for population growth. It tells you that if you marry early, okay, that means you have married too early, and if you marry early, obviously you're going to have kids also early. So if you're going to have kids early, then your bandwidth of having number of kids also increases. Now suppose if a girl is marrying at 30, okay, then what will happen, her bandwidth of actually producing kids is reducing because the biologically it is allowed only till 35. Now suppose if she is getting married at 14 or 15, so she can produce or reproduce babies till 16, 17 years of her life. So this is a problem because then what will happen, she will she either because of her in-laws, because of pressure, she will keep producing kids. Okay, there might be some meta preference also, so such things will be a problem. So too early, that means if you marry too early, then you will have too many kids also. So this problem of too early too many is solved, and ultimately it leads to population growth control. Okay, so we have shown how education has led to population growth control. Now similarly, what we'll do is we'll take like second example. So second example is basically economic empowerment of women. What is it? Economic empowerment of women. So what you'll do, again you'll make this square and then you'll write economic empowerment of women. That means what? Yahan pe, that means what, that she is in workforce. Okay, that means what, she is facing the dual burden of family, okay, and work. That means what? What is a dual burden? Please, I'm requesting you use such keywords because these are the keywords that attract the attention of the person who is checking your paper. If you just write burden of family and work, dual burden, no, she is getting burdened by both, by family also, by work also. Even though she is, she is going to earn, probably she is earning more than her husband, but still the family work is only women's responsibility. So such things, you know, instead of writing such a huge paragraph, you just write it as dual burden. So obviously now what is happening, she has a dual burden of family and work. That will lead to what? That will lead to she not reproducing, or she not basically having too many kids, because if she has too many kids, they all are her responsibility. So she won't have more kids, and then it leads to population growth control. Now are you understanding how beautifully what we have done? We beautifully make these cycles, and then you know we are actually trying to convey the message of how each type of empowerment is leading to population growth control. Now third empowerment, what we'll take, so education is done. Then you can write basically what was the fourth kind of empowerment? Yeah, so then we'll write political empowerment also. Okay, how will political empowerment lead? See, when the woman is in politics, okay, what will happen, that she is the one responsible for making policies, okay, taking care of the constituency that she is ruling, and then taking care of the what, policies also of the government. Now what is the policy of the government? Hum do, hamare do, Okay, so now if the woman is woman has to actually, you know, woman is a like she is politically empowered. That means she is either an MP sitting in the parliament, or she is an MLA, or she is a member of the local bodies. Now, whichever case it is, okay, she is the one who is a spokesperson of the government. Now, if the government is promoting hum do hamare do, that means what? She has to actually follow it. So she cannot have like 11 or 12 kids. That is what? That is why what will happen? She will not. Basically, she will promote the actively government policies of active government policies of having only two kids. Okay, and ultimately it will lead to population growth control. So what I have done is, again I have taken one kind of empowerment and linked it to other. Okay, now suppose the fourth kind of empowerment will be what? See, fourth kind of empowerment can be social empowerment of women. Okay, so now what I'll give you as a homework is to draw a cycle for this social empowerment. Okay, just like what we have done, no, here we are drawing cycles or drawing like linear diagrams. You please do it for social empowerment also. That how social empowerment of women can lead to population growth control. In this way, you will feel more confident of how you have understood and then you have applied the knowledge also. And in the end, you write that women empowerment. Okay, women actually empowered. Empowerment leads to population growth control. So in the end, you are just asserting. And why are you asserting it again? Because the question was discussed. Okay, these are like the key concepts you should know. When you have to assert your answer, when do you have to actually, you know, criticize whatever is written in the statement. So here it was not critically analyzed or it was not criticized. So you can't come and criticize and say, no, empowering women will not lead to population. And here, you know, if you want to make your answer much better, you can include the case study also. You can write the case study of how, you know, in Scandinavian countries where we see women are more empowered, okay, more participatory in terms of economic, social and political life, you will find that the population growth is also less, okay. And that is what is true for India also. So if you compare rural versus urban, if you compare north versus south, the clear, you know, analogy is that in south you have much more literacy rate, in north you have lesser literacy rate. Okay, in south women are more actively participating in economic activities, in north it's not the case. And that is why you'll find that in south India the total fertility rate has already reduced less than 2.1, but in north India, specifically in these 8 empowered action group states, do you remember what is empowered action group states? Oh god, you need to know what are empowered action group states. So empowered action group states are basically those 8 states which are basically lagging behind in certain parameters, and the government is also trying to bring them at par. These include the Bimaru states. Okay, that Bihar, Madhya Pradesh, Uttar Pradesh, Rajasthan, so all these states. So now these empowered action group states, you will find the total fertility rate is still 2.3 or 2.4. So that means what? The fertility rate is really high. Okay? So this is an important point. So you have given North India versus South India. You have given Scandinavian countries versus India. And now you can go rural versus urban also. Na? In rural areas, what is happening? The women are not empowered. They are married early. And that is why you will find that in rural areas, average number of children, okay, per household is actually 5. Remember the Ayushman Bharat scheme the government has launched? It said that the scheme is launched for 10 crore poor families. But it was always repeatedly saying that it will help 50 crore people. Now tell me, how will 10 crore family become 50 crore people? Only when there are 5 people per family. Okay. And how will they be there 5 people? There will be mother, father and 3 children. That means on an average, you're assuming in a rural household, there will be like 5 people or 3 children. Versus urban household, which we are seeing that they're now even going towards producing only 1 children. So rural versus urban. So always, all this I'm telling you, you have to write these diagrams, and then, you know, in the end you can write some case study or examples, and then write Scandinavia versus India, you can write rural versus urban, and North India versus South India. And in the end you can conclude with that empowering women is actually the key to control population growth. Okay, this forms your amazing answer. Okay, wherein out of 10 you will definitely end up getting how much? At least 6. At least you can go till 7 also. So now what we'll do, we'll go towards the next question. So the next question is asking you about the, it is a question number 10. It is again a 10 marker question. 10 marker question are basically 150 words question. Okay, so that is why I told you it's optional for you to write example or not, because you cannot replace your content with example. example should be always an add-on. Okay, so you have to first of all take that example that is self-explanatory, so that you don't waste your words and space on the example explanation. And secondly, is in the cases of 10 markers, examples do not form the, you can say examples are not compulsory, because it's a very short question. It's a only 150 word question. So content is important, and with that, if you can write and manage your example, then that's great. Okay. So now again, we'll solve one 10 marker question, which is about the challenges to our cultural practices in the name of secularism. Okay. So what is it asking you? It is asking you how, basically, in name of secularism, that means maybe you're truly secular or not, it doesn't matter. But in the name of basically establishing secularism, how you are challenging our cultural practices, or what are the challenges that our cultural practices are facing. Okay. So in this question, first of all, see, this question, I know a lot of people did not attempt because they couldn't understand. This question is asking you about the negative points of secularism. So we have always talked about positive points of secularism, that how, you know, secularism should be there, or how secularism is important to maintain harmony, it is important to maintain peace, okay, a democratic fabric of the country, it is important to basically harbor diversity in the country, and it is important so that there are no riots, there are no, you can say, especially communal riots happening in the country. So that is why we used to say that secularism is important. But now what they're asking is that how secularism has become a threat to our cultural practices. So that is why a lot of people did not answer this, because they've always studied about the positive points of secularism. Okay. So now, first of all, you will write that secularism. So you also have an introduction, body, conclusion. And since bodies, you have to explicitly write about the challenges which our cultural practices are facing in name of secularism. So in the first introduction, I would tell you to define secularism. You can write secularism, okay, is a basic feature of constitution. And here you can write in the bracket, case one and then Bharti case 1973. Okay. And also basically mentioned in preamble of constitution. Okay. Secularism. So now what you've done is you have introduced via secularism. Okay. And you can say that secularism wants to establish a society where each and every religion, okay, bounds to be equally protected. Okay. So that means you're establishing that how secularism is trying to do what. And now in the body, you will start writing the challenges. So here only you will start that, but there are many challenges that our cultural practices face in the name of secularism. But I'm again telling you, this question is asking you negative aspect of secularism, but in conclusion, you'll end it in a positive note. You will say how, in spite of these challenges, basically secularism still remains, okay, still remains a most important ideal for our country, considering that our country is harboring so many religions. Okay. But we need to ensure that secularism we need to only ensure that the negative aspects of secularism are avoided. So that means what you have done is you have actually shown that you are not a person who is not valuing secularism. See, this question, I know people can go to extremes of saying something, okay, in this question, then it might be required also, considering that question is only asking you negative aspect. But are you a negative person? No. Then why will you end a question, okay, which is asking you that secularism is bad? It is, you know, creating problems for our cultural practices. So yes, it is creating. There are few challenges, but secularism is also needed. In a society like India, where we have Hinduism, Buddhism, Jainism, Islam, Christianity, Baha'ism, okay, even people who are agnostic, atheist, so all of them living together in one place, okay, obviously it's bound to create some challenges. But then, can you leave secularism? Answer is no. Because if you leave secularism, it will hamper the growth of the country. It will create more communal riots. It will create more tensions. It will disturb the social harmony. And this is where you need to end it. That how, in spite of these challenges, what we need to do is to ensure that these challenges do not remain. But secularism as an ideal, secularism as a, or you can say as an objective, has to be achieved. Okay. So this forms like a very good answer. So now, after writing introduction, what have you written in introduction? You have written about In introduction, you have written about the definition of secularism and how secularism is mentioned in Indian Constitution's preamble, and it was also declared by judiciary under the under its basic structure, okay, which it defined in Case Panandan Bharati case. Now what you'll do is, in body you will write however, okay, because you're writing about secularism, what it means, you can write however, okay, our cultural practices have been facing challenges because of secularism. That because we want to establish secularism, sometimes it happens that we overboard and our cultural practices actually face lot of problems. Okay, so now what you will do is, you start mentioning about the cultural practices because of which you are facing problems. Okay, so first of all here, see, have you heard of the word judicio-papism? Okay, so judicio-papism, okay, I'll just write it neatly so that you know the definition. Judicio-papism. Okay, so judicio-papism actually means over-interference of judiciary in the matters of religion. Okay, so here, what are we doing? We are writing the threats because of secularism. So see, first of all, you will write judicio-papism and now you will explain it. So you will write that judiciary is to ensure that ideals of constitutions, okay, or secularism have to be achieved. But because of it, it is interfering in religious matters. Okay, for example, it has decided in many cases, okay, what is an essential religious practice and what is not. And what is the example here? It will be basically example of Santhara. Okay, Santhara is a practice in Jainism wherein they fast unto death. Okay, and in Rajasthan High Court, what happened was that they declared this practice illegal because they considered it as a suicide, right? It's a suicide, or you can also say it's a suicide basically. So they did not allow this, and they said it's wrong. Okay, and they said that for practicing of Jainism, this is not an essential religious practice. Then when this matter went to Supreme Court, obviously Supreme Court said that A, this Rajasthan court's judgment stands abolished, because Rajasthan court or any other court in the country cannot decide what is an essential religious practice. You can only uphold, you can only, you know, like demolish any other practices apart from essential religious practices, but you cannot decide that what is essential religious practice. It is on the community itself to decide whether it is essential or not. And for Jainism, Santhara was essential, because it is, if you read about the Jainism tenets, it says, right, fast unto death is one of the measures of how you can end your life. And that is why then Supreme Court said, okay, fine, Santhara is allowed. So now this is called as judicio-papism, where judiciary is over interfering in your religious affairs in the name of secularism, because they are like, other religion did not have a practice like Santhara, so how can you have it? But they forgot that even in Hinduism also you have something called as Samadhi. What is Samadhi? Wherein the person goes, he basically himself or herself basically takes like a dip in that water, okay, in water, and it remains until the breath goes out. And even if you know that the Lakshman and Ram, they all went for Samadhi, which is done in the Samundar or in a river. So it's not like, so now if suppose tomorrow judiciary will come and say that the Samadhi is also not a essential religious practice, so then judiciary can't decide. I'm not saying the practice is right or wrong. I'm just saying who is to decide whether it is essential to religion or not. That is the people of that religion. Okay, so this is basically in the name of secularism how judiciary is interfering in the cultural practices. Now we move to the second example. The second example would be the example of, what will be the example? Yeah, the example of Sabarimala. And here what you'll do is, you know, I always tell people that please read important judgments, not the summary. Because what is happening in Sabarimala also, you might find that there was a judge called Indu Malhotra, and she basically was against providing entry to women in Sabarimala. And her points as to what she gave becomes your answer. Because in Sabarimala, what is happening, she said that first of all, why only this temple are we after? Because this is the only temple wherein the Lord who is present there, he is actually in the celibacy state. So what is the point of actually allowing women and inserting their rights over such a temple when the God itself is in celibacy state? Then secondly, it said that if you want to establish equality, it cannot be only women above men. Okay, it has to be men above women also. It has to be men equaling women, not above women. So basically she said that, you know, there are many Shakti temples where men are not allowed. So should we allow men also? Because it's a question of equality. Right? So now, see, I am very much a promoter of women's entry to Sabarimala or any other temple, because this is the case of Article 14. But Supreme Court in this judgment also took Article 17. It said that, you know, it has become a class untouchability issue, that you're not allowing a class and the classes of women to basically enter a temple because you're calling them as, you're treating them as untouchables. And to this, Indu Malhotra said that it is not the question of Article 17, because Article 17 is about the caste system. You cannot actually increase or decrease the constitution's meaning or the article's meaning according to whenever you please or whenever you wish. Now, because we have to write a question, we will end up writing this part also. Okay, so what you will do is, you will write here example Sabarimala, or you will write women entries issue, and you will write how in the case of Sabarimala temple entry case, okay, we saw that these points were neglected. We will not say who said them, because otherwise it will become judiciary issue. So you will write basically how these points were neglected. And that is why we can say how in the name of secularism, the cultural practices, see, probably the cultural practices of the, you know, people which are very sanctum unto them, they are getting avoided. Now what we will write is, basically we will write the third point, but before that we will just remove this. So now, then the third point where we can say, because of the secularism, the cultural practices are getting impacted, will be minorities. So you might have seen that, see, minorities are what? Minority is just a person who does not have a majority. So if you compare Hindu versus Muslim, Muslims are minority. Okay, but if you compare Hindu versus Christians, Christians are minority. But if you go to northeastern states, you will find that Christianity is in majority, and there Hinduism is in minority. So minority is a very relative concept. You cannot say that this is a particular minority. Okay, so now minority can be either on the basis of your language, it can be basis of your cultural practices, your ethnic practices, and now how on the basis of secularism you are wanting to basically, you are overpowering these minorities. You're not letting them live only. So you can say, you can talk about how in the recent past also we have seen that many minorities, okay, they are getting overpowered because of the in the name of secularism, like their culture is threatened. Okay, and how is their cultural threatened? So obviously if your entire district is following some one religion, okay, and one religion or one type of culture, or you can say that, yeah, one kind of religion, but you are the one who are not following it. You have seen Sikh riots in northeastern Meghalaya happening. That means what? Where basically Sikh people were attacked by the northeastern Meghalayan people, and they were, you know, told that how they are taking away their jobs. So now Sikhism is in minority in northeast, and we need to protect it. In the name of secularism, they are also saying that, you know, they have a very different cultural practices and they do not match with the background. So somewhere we are trying to overpower them. Okay, and lastly you can talk about the, so we are done with Sabarimala, we are done with minority, and we are also done with judicial papism. Okay, the one more, here 150 words are over. So either you leave it here, or you can write one or two more points. Okay, here I want to write what is one more point, which is basically Uniform Civil Code. Okay, because what is happening, Uniform Civil Code was in news, and if you mention it, that it tells you that you are not a static person, but you are someone who is also in the dynamic sphere. Okay, you know what is happening in and around. So how, see, what is a Uniform Civil Code? The word itself tells you, it's a Uniform Civil Code. That means it's a code, it's a book of laws, okay, that will be made for civic laws. Okay, and it will try to create or bring about uniformity. Now, if you know that Uniform Civil Code is mentioned in DPSP's under Article 44 of the Constitution, okay, where it is said that state shall ensure to establish Uniform Civil Code, but it does not mention when, because even our constitution makers did not know whether it will become a reality or not. And now, if you know, then there was a blueprint that was released as to you know what will be there in Uniform Civil Code, etc. And there were huge, you can say, like uproar in the public saying that we do not want, you know, so Uniform Civil Code, it will bring uniformity. So you can say that how, in the name of secularism, now you are basically trying to bring about uniformity within the religions and also among religions. So it might actually, you can say, it, the religions might lose out their crux. So here we have all written negative. But in the conclusion, what you'll write is, however, okay, having said that, or however, basically, secularism is a major aspect of society because India is blah, 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 blah. India has so many religions. India basically is a, you know, India is like a conglomerate of so many religions. And you can say that secularism is a basic feature. Otherwise, it will lead to more tensions. Or you can say, if we need to ensure communal harmony and peace in the society. So you can end it positive also, or you can end negative also. I will prefer you end it this way, that if you want to create communal harmony, then we need secularism. You don't write that it, otherwise it will create tension, because then you're ending at a negative note. Okay? So this is the broader picture of how you write an answer. See, no institution, I'm telling you again, no institution is going to tell you how to write. What they do is actually they take the paper, they have their sources, and they start copying pasting from those sources. Okay, but the point is, when you suppose, how am I able to tell you this? Because I was the one who was sitting in the exam. Okay, I know exactly what came to my mind and what did not cross my mind. So the point is, you don't have to fall for such model answers wherein they're just writing content as facts, because those facts, trust me, won't occur to you in examination. What you need to do is, you need to see that can you write an answer wherein every point might occur to you in the examination hall, and especially when the papers happen morning and evening, okay, 3 days, 4 days together. After that, trust me, nobody's brains is working. Like the last paper, I think, of ethics, people are just like, oh my God, we're done. Like their brain stops working. So how will you remember the facts, like very, very crude facts of when Munda rebellion happened, when Santhal? No, just write the basics about it. If you remember the leader, for example, Birsa Munda, then write about Birsa Munda. No, nobody's asking you to write about the year. Okay, this is the difference between how you can actually benefit from a coaching versus how you are actually, you know, wasting the time. You don't have to sit and watch the model answers paper, because there are no model answers. I would have gotten 110 in history, somebody else might have gotten 105 in GS1, okay, or 112 also. But 110 and 112 do not have much gap. But my paper attempting might be very, very different from the from that guy or a person or a girl or a boy who has attempted, because their answer writing might be very, very different. They might be writing in paragraphs. Does that mean that we are not good? No. Answer is, we are equally good, but our perception of answer writing is different. That's what I'm telling you. Create your own perception about answer writing. In every question, you need to identify, can we draw flowcharts? Answer is yes or no. Can we actually, you know, write some extra points? Can we write some extra case studies? Can we write some example which can impress the examiner? So this will actually give you like one of those one extra point, one and a half extra point, and you will be through. Okay? Then we will talk about the question number 11. It talks about that how many voices have strengthened and enriched the national movement during the Gandhian phase. And now the word is elaborate. So you don't have to counter this. You just have to elaborate. Whatever is written, whatever statement is written, you just need to expand it. You just need to elaborate it. Okay. So now the question is that many voices. Okay. Of these many voices can be any. They can be, you know, class-wise, they can be caste-wise, they can be religious, they can be women versus men, they can be rural versus urban, they can be traders, they can be workers, they can be zamindars, they can be industrialists. Now, imagine I've given you so many parts of the answer only. Okay, so it is asking you that how many voices have strengthened and enriched. Okay, that these many voices have enriched and strengthened the nationalist movement during the Gandhian phase. Now, the catch here is, Gandhian phase. Okay, when did Gandhian phase start? Post 1915. Okay, and it went all till the freedom struggle. So now what you'll do is, you'll take each of these voices, and start explaining that how they've enriched and strengthened the national movement, because the answer is only to elaborate. So here, if you do not even write conclusion, it is fine, but in the conclusion I will just say, just repeat this line that, you know, that so however, or as seen, we see that, or as concluded from above, that there were many, many voices who actually enriched the national movement in the Gandhian phase, which ultimately led to India achieving independence. Okay, so this is how you connect it, because it's the voice, collective voice of so many people, so many kinds of different people, that ultimately gave India independence. So now, first of all, you have to write introduction. So you will, in introduction, since it is asking you about the Gandhian phase nationalist movement, you will write about Gandhian phase nationalist movement. Okay, you will write how nationalist movement, okay, after going from a moderate, and in the bracket you write 1885 to 1905, to extremist 1905 to 1950, ended with the Gandhian phase, and in the bracket you mention 1915 till 1947. Okay, and you can write that in Gandhian phase, because of the methods like satyagraha, ahimsa, okay, truth, you'll find that so many different voices or different people actually became the part of nationalist movement. Okay, so I'm just making it clearer here. So introduction, body and conclusion. In introduction, what you will write, you'll mention how the nationalist movement went from moderate phase to extremist to Gandhian phase. And here you will write year so that the examiner understands that you know what you're writing. Then in the second part, you'll write in the Gandhian phase, okay, ultimately we saw so many different voices coming together because of the use of methods like satyagraha, like ahimsa, like truth. Because see, women were not participating actively because of the violence involved. But now when Gandhi said, okay, there will be non-violence, then what happened? Large amount of women started participating. So thus you have set a pretext to your question. Now what you'll write in the body, you'll write about how many voices have actually strengthened and enriched the national movement during the Gandhian phase. And here you will write, many voices have strengthened and enriched the Gandhian phase. And here you will see, there are two ways to attempt this question. Either you can just write that how, like in one liners, what, for example, if you have to write many voices were enriching the national movement, you can write examples of, for example, non-cooperation movement, and start writing how different people participated. So I'll give you two ways to solve this question. Okay, one is going event-wise and one is going the class-wise or voices-wise. Okay, first I'll tell you how to write event-wise. What you will do in event is, you will divide the Gandhian phase into different events. For example, when Gandhi arrived, he went to Champaran, then he went to Ahmedabad, and then he went to Kheda. So all these three together. Then you will have, basically Khilafat movement. Okay. Then you can have non-cooperation movement. Then you can also have this Bardoli Satyagraha. Okay. Then you can have civil disobedience movement. Okay. Then you can have Quit India movement, you can have individual satyagraha. So what you will do is, you will start basically writing events that happened in the Gandhian phase, and you will show that how in each of these events we have different section of people or different voice coming, so that now you are showing them that how many voices came together and strengthened the nationalist struggle. For example, in Champaran you saw peasants. So in Champaran you saw basically peasants plight. In Ahmedabad you saw workers plight. In Kheda again it was peasants. For example, in Khilafat movement you saw Muslims joining the national freedom struggle. Similarly, in the national non-cooperation movement you saw what? You saw large amount of rural people joining, no? Because that time you will find that Congress expanded its membership in the rural areas also. It reduced the membership fees. Okay, it also made this Swaraj fund, this Tilak fund, which was oversubscribed because it had a lot of money in it. So how rural people basically joined this movement. Similarly, you will find that Bardoli is also about peasants. Okay, and in civil disobedience movement, you can write basically how women participated in this movement a lot. For example, Sarojini Naidu. Okay. Similarly, you can write how here. Okay. In Quit India movement, yeah, here. So in Quit India movement, you will write how industrialist and you can say students participated a lot. Okay, because industrialists are the one giving the money for Quit India movement, and students are the one who are actually continuing the movement once the movement became leaderless. When all the leaders, okay, Nehru, Gandhi, all of them got actually prisoned, and then the movement was leaderless, but then the students continued it. Okay, so now similarly, you can also write one or two revolutionary events here, and you can write how revolutionaries, okay, also participated in the event. So now what you have done is you have described that how different voices came together and they strengthened the national freedom struggle. This was one way of solving the question. Now the second way of solving the question is what I told you. It is basically going class wise. Instead of going event wise, you go class wise. So you will write that many voices which strengthened the Gandhian freedom struggle. Basically, then first you will write peasants. And then you will write all the events where peasants basically participated in the national freedom struggle. And here you can start from where are the peasants? Champaran, then Kheda, and then Bardoli. Okay. And here you can also write, okay, let it be Bardoli, otherwise it will become really, really long. So how Champaran, Kheda, and Bardoli peasants basically gave their voice to the freedom struggle where they were wanting to discuss the plight of their own. Then second is the participation of tribals, and in tribals you can write both. You can write Tebhaga movement and you can write Telangana movement, because these both movements happened in the Gandhian phase, and they in some word they actually strengthen the national freedom struggle. Then third, after peasants and tribals, what do you have? In after peasants and tribal, you can write Muslims, right? Because that is also as a community, it started participating in national freedom struggle via Khilafat. Okay, so you can write Khilafat movement, wherein Muslims basically actively participated in the Indian freedom struggle during the Gandhian phase. Then fourth, you can write about the workers. Okay, workers, for workers we will first write All India Trade Union Congress formed in 1920 by Lala Lajpat Rai, and then you will write these railway workers, mill strikes. Okay, so all these happening, and where basically workers are demanding, and they're asking, they're also participating, they are actually not letting the trains etc. run because they want to show solidarity towards their nation. Here you can also write that workers and peasants party that was formed. Then fifth, if workers are participating, you can also write how basically industrialist class, okay, all these businessmen, for example Jamnalal Bajaj, for example who was also there? Jamnalal Bajaj was there. There are many other Purushottam Das, etc., who are giving their voice to the industry. And they also gave this Bombay plan. Okay, you can write about this Bombay plan, of how they gave basically Bombay plan also to revive the economy during, like after the freedom struggle. Then what is the sixth class that you can think of? You can think of women. So women, basically the participation, you can write about any basins. Okay, what you will do in women is you need to give example also. So you will write civil disobedience movement, and you will write the example of Sarojini Naidu. You will write Quit India movement, and you will write the example of this one, Usha Mehta, okay, running the underground radio. Okay, so in this way, what you will do is basically you are giving that how women are also, increasing their voice in the freedom struggle, because of the, see, issues can be different of why, see, each of them is joining according to their issues. But the larger part is the more the people are joining the freedom struggle, okay, be it any issues, they're actually, wanting to throw out British. The point is that. So you're already given six here. Here you can also add seventh, which will be Zamindars. Okay. Then eighth will be, you can write rural people. Okay, or villagers, etc. So in this way, what you're doing is you're actually, you're telling them that you're not restricting to only one class. You've given them multiple classes, and how each of these classes actually participating in the national freedom struggle. So either you go this wise or you go event wise. The choice is yours, because everybody has a different way of writing. So now I'm telling you, see, in any way, in both the cases you must have seen the example is almost the same, because here even if you are going class wise, you are actually describing events. If you are going event wise, you are describing the class that is supporting that event. Okay, so both anyways you have to write even in class, but it's on you whether you want to take it event wise or you want to take it class wise. And in the end you will write that this is how we see it. It was because of the efforts of all these classes that India ultimately became independent, okay, in 1947. Because it was the efforts, collective efforts of all these classes that made India independent. Okay, So I hope that you are actually liking the sessions of how you can write an exam, because in exam only this is going to stuck to you. Okay, if you think about anything else, those things might not even appear to you. So write about the things that everybody knows and you also remember, but write them properly. Write them in the way that examiner can just understand what you're trying to write. Then we'll talk about the question number 12. Okay, what is the question number 12 telling you? It is asking you or telling you to assess the role of British imperial power in complicating the process of transfer of power during the 1940s. Okay, so the question is assess. This is the keyword that you have to assess, whether it was right, whether it was wrong, whether it happened or whether it not happened. And then in the end, you have to suitably conclude, because it is your assessment. My assessment, your assessment can be different. So my conclusion will be different from yours. You can say that the British imperial power did not complicate the process, and hence you can conclude in another way. But here you can also support the statement by saying that yes, they actually complicated the process of transfer of power, and this is how you conclude. Okay, I'm telling you right now, only assessment is each person's individual assessment. They can support, they cannot support the statement. But here generally, see, whenever UPSC is giving you to assess something, until it is totally negative, like it is telling you secularism is bad, okay, they are telling you women are stupid, don't actually, you know, like take an opposite stand. Until unless they are only giving you such a negative stand that you cannot take. Otherwise, what you do is you take the statement, you basically give like 10 points in for if, in support of it, and then in the last 2 points in the conclusion or in just the like pre-conclusion paragraph, you can just mention of how there is other side also, if you want to mention, and then end suitably. Okay, so please understand the keywords and the demand of the keywords. Otherwise, it will become really hard for you to actually, you know, nag the question, because then question will be asking something and you will be answering the other thing. So don't let that complication happen. So what I'll do is, I'll give you this question 12 as a homework, and then in the next video or in the next class, we'll start with question 12. Because after teaching you almost 7 questions, okay, which is like 1/3 of the paper, it's important that you also start writing or start at least, you know, practicing how to write. So this is very important for me. So please take a pen and a paper and start solving this question, and see how will you answer that, how did the British power or imperial power complicated the process of transfer of power, and when is it asking? It is asking in 1940s, and this is the challenge. This is where a lot of people actually forgot the knowledge, and this is what I say, that calmness helps. All you needed to do was just understand what happened in 1940s. Like, switch your brain to 1940s. Do not even think what happened before. After 1940s, what happened, and see how British acted then. And were they actually complicating the process of transfer of power or not? You will ultimately get your answer. Okay? So, solve this question and we will meet in the next class again. Thank you.